grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
I invite the congregation to stand for the thanksgiving for baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism,
we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness.
Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight.
God delights in me.
Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all.
God chose me to be his child.
We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life, and above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love.
God fills me with his Spirit.
To you be an honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us now pray the prayer of the day. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus Christ, most merciful Redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day, praising you with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Jesus gave his mandate, share the good news, that he came to save us and set us free. Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Let none be forgotten throughout the world. In the triune name of God, go and baptize. Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy.
This is Psalm 139, verses 1 through 18, and we will read it responsively. O Lord, you have searched me and known me.
You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away.
You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways.
Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely.
You hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it.
Where can I go from your spirit?
Or where can I flee from your presence?
If I ascend to heaven, you are there.
If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there.
If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea,
Even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast.
If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you.
The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you.
For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Wonderful are your works that I know very well.
My frame was not hidden from you. When I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld my unformed substance.
In your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed.
How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God! How vast is the sum of them!
I try to count them. They are more than the sand. I come to the end. I am still with you.
A reading from the first book of Samuel, chapter 3, verses 1 through 20. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called,
Samuel, Samuel.
And he said,
Here I am.
And ran to Eli and said,
Here I am, for you called me.
I did not call. Lie down again.
So he went and lay down. The Lord called again,
Samuel.
Samuel got up and went to Eli and said,
Here I am, for you called me.
I did not call, my son. Lie down again.
Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said,
Here I am, for you called me.
Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel,
Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.
So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before.
Samuel, Samuel.
Speak, for your servant is listening.
See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever. For the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever.
Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision of Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said,
Samuel, my son.
Here I am.
What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also, if you hide anything from me of all that he told you.
So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him.
It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him.
As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Just take it with you, put it on my desk.
Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Now, if you've gone to Sunday school all your life, you probably already know this story. And in fact, this story is as simple as it needs to be and is an invitation that we're invited to do. It is both the simplest thing and one of the hardest things in all the world to do. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Simply go to your place, listen, and then say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And you see, the challenge is that most people, when, excuse me a minute, when most people talk about praying to God, they talk about the requests that they're talking to God about, the concerns that they have. We fill the prayers with words at God. But God not only wants to speak to us, God is speaking to us. It's one of the great paradoxes of God that God is literally speaking to us every moment of every day, and we most hardly ever hear him. God speaks, but we're not listening. Now, the annoying part of God is that the story of Samuel is really an anomaly. It's one of the few places where God speaks with an audible voice. Most of the time when the scriptures say God speaks, you probably should get the idea that this is a thought in the mind, an impression in the heart, that it is by our own interpretation of a scripture passage, of what we know about the character of God, and that when the person says God spoke, it's often that way. But for Samuel, he was blessed to have an audible voice of God speak to him. And he did exactly what Eli told him. He went to his place. He got silent. And he invited God to speak. Now, there's a lot of listening going on in this story. And a lot of not listening going on in this story. Now, the book of Samuel, the first book of Samuel, is all about the call of Samuel. But it's about a major change in the life of the people of Israel. For you see, Eli is the last, well, next to the last, because Samuel becomes the last of the judges. You see, when God called the people into the land, he said, I'm not going to put a king over you. I'm going to have one who listens to the voice of God and speaks to you what I want said. And when the people listened and did what the judges told them to do, what God had said, then they prospered. And when they refused to listen, then things went badly for them. But the problem is, Eli doesn't hear the voice of God. Oh, he wears the robe and he has the office and he speaks as if God has spoken to him, but he can't actually hear God speak. And when he does speak, he doesn't even realize that he's speaking for God. You see, the story actually begins with a man named Elkanah who had two wives, Peninnah and Hannah. And Peninnah was quite fertile, had sons and daughters, and Hannah did not. I don't know if you're one of those persons who is a woman who wanted children yet could not. I have spoken or read stories about many women who've had that experience, and one woman who it took her quite a while and a great deal of work with the doctors to become pregnant. She said Mother's Day was just an agony for her. And it was tearing her up on the inside when her friends would invite them to their baby showers. Or she would go over to their house and their children were playing. She said, you can't imagine the agony in my soul. Well, Hannah knew that agony because Penaniah, the sister wife, put it in her face, tormented her about it, if not the fact that the children running around was not torment enough. Now, her husband, Elkanah, he didn't hear the torment in Hannah's soul. He said, well, I'm better to you than 12 sons. I give you more than any other husband gives his wife. What are you complaining about? He can't hear the cry of her heart. So it all comes to head one day when they're down at Shiloh, or I should say up at Shiloh, a place where there was a meeting place for the Lord. And Hannah is pouring out her prayer of desperation to God. And she's praying with such fervor that she makes a vow and a bargain with God. She says that if you will give me a son, I'll give him back to you. And not only will I give him back to you, but I promise he'll never drink wine or strong drink in that society, meaning he's only going to drink water, and he'll never cut his hair. Well, Eli sees all of this going on, and he sees this woman, and her lips are moving, but he can't hear anything. And this is an indication of the way that prayers were done back then, because he says to her, woman, quit your drinking. Don't bring your drunkenness here into the place of the Lord. Be gone from you, woman. And she says, oh, no, sir, I'm praying out of the desperation of my heart. He very carelessly says to her, go on your way, your prayer is answered. And then it says her countenance was lifted. And I think that's a sign that her faith trusted that the prayer would be answered. And as the story goes on, she does indeed become pregnant and bear a son. She has him until she weans him. What are we talking? 2 years? 3 years? Maybe? Probably not. Certainly not four. But once she has him weaned, she goes up to the festival and she brings her son to Eli and says, here is the child who you told me God would send. I give him to you to care and to raise. I give him to the Lord. He has been lent to me, and I give it to her, give it to you, Lord. And then I think in one of the most heart-rending lines in all of the scriptures, it says, she left him with Eli before the Lord. Oh my. Can you imagine the hurt in her soul to do that? Every year she would come back and she would bring him clothing that was one size larger and see him once a year. What a gift. What a vow. What a prayer in answer to prayer. But you see, all is not right with Eli, because Eli's sons are serving as priests before the God, but they're not obedient to any of the rituals, and they do them all wrong. They take things for themselves. They're greedy. They're not faithful to their wives, but they sleep around with the temple serving girls. And in fact, God sends a prophet. We don't know anything more than that. He's just a prophet who comes to Eli and says, because you have not obeyed God, the disaster is going to come upon you. Your son shall die, you shall die, and only one in your household will be left to see. I will break the promise that I made to you that your sons will continue forever because you have been disobedient. Eli though he had the scriptures and he had the things of God, was not listening to God. So it's particularly amazing that Samuel grows up to be a young boy who is able to hear God's voice. And Eli was perceptive enough to tell Samuel to go and listen. But you see, the thing is about listening, and this is a wonderful story. And I invite you to pray this prayer on a regular basis. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. The church has a wonderful tradition of doing things called centering prayer. Spending 20 minutes in the morning and 20 minutes at the night saying these words and then just simply being silent. Another form of prayer, similar to that one, is to say this line, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening," and then just simply allow the silence to settle. And as soon as you get distracted, you say the line again to bring yourself back to attention. Because you see, the way that God speaks is not with an audible voice. He speaks through an insight from the scriptures, through a feeling in the soul, through even silence itself. Samuel does indeed learn, after years of practice, to listen to God. Now, what happens in this story is that God is actually listening to the prayers of the people. The prayers of the people who are calling for someone righteous to lead them. And so that's why Samuel is sent. And Samuel is a good judge. But the Lord is doing something even deeper than the people realize. For eventually they come to Samuel and say, "We want a king." And so after Samuel prays to God and it's a complicated story. He doesn't want to give up his power, but eventually he does. Saul is anointed, but Saul refuses to listen to the word of God and to do what God told him to do through Samuel. And because Saul is not the king who is listening to God, God sends Samuel to Jesse. And somehow he had the impression that he must go to Jesse and anoint one of his sons. I mean, it doesn't say whether it's an audible voice or not, but I would suspect it was not. And this is why I suspect it. Now, Samuel realizes this is a dangerous, dangerous journey. He knows that if Saul sees him going, that Saul will have him killed. And see, he goes under a sort of a undercover, so to speak. And they have a festival, and he goes to Jesse's house, and he sees Eli, the oldest son of Jesse, come in. And my golly, that guy is immense. He's got the broad shoulders. He's got the tapered waist. He's got the square face. He is just a fine physical specimen of man, and Samuel says to himself, "That's it! That's the Lord's anointed! That's the one!" And this is how you know that Samuel has begun to hear the Lord at a deeper level. For he reports the story, saying that God said to him, "Do not look on his outward appearance, for the Lord does not look on the outward appearance, but on the heart." And then it said, seven sons pass in front of Samuel, and Samuel says to Jesse each time, "No, that's not the one. No, that's not the one. No, that." How does he know that? Because he hasn't had that touch in his spirit. He hasn't had that awareness that God is speaking to him. Until finally, as you know the story, the last son is out in the fields, and they go and get him, and then, of course, it's David, and the Lord says, this is the one, anoint him. Now, I tell you this whole thing because I invite you to practice listening. You would think that folks would recognize that listening to God is hard. We know that playing a musical instrument is hard. We know that playing any sport is hard. We know that learning any fine skill is hard. It takes practice, it takes work, it takes determination, and keeping after it day after day. And yet we sort of think if we just simply say, speak, Lord, your servant is listening, we'll be able to hear. And the reason we can't hear is, first of all, we don't do the hard work. We don't do it day after day after day. I would challenge you in your prayer time in the coming week to spend more time listening to God, however that practice works for you, than you do speaking to God. Try it. You'll find out how hard it is. But the second reason that we don't hear God is that we don't understand that God's voice comes differently. And so we don't realize that we might have spent some significant time in silence and heard nothing and felt nothing except our rear end getting tired and us getting annoyed that nothing is happening, only to recognize later in the day a flash of insight to a question that we've been wondering about for quite some time. And we go, oh, if we're paying attention, that's God's voice. So we need to work at it. We need to recognize it, that it comes in unusual and different ways. But thirdly, we need a bit of discernment. And here's where our world gets in trouble. Because not every thought, not every impression, not every idea comes from God. And that's why I find it so hard to preach. Because if there's anything I want to do, I want to speak what God wants me to say, and no more and no less. And yet I know that there's a whole lot of Doug and Doug's experience and Doug's worldview mixed up in how I perceive what God is saying. There's a whole bunch of my culture and all that I've learned from the world and the way the world understands it's a part of my thinking. And even worse, there is that which would lie to me and lead me astray. And that's what the practice is for. And that's what the discerning of the voice is for. To recognize, when am I saying, this is what God once said? This is what God is saying? And when is it that it's all about Doug? Or all about the ways of the world? Or even the ways of the evil one. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. That's the invitation. And in fact, if you say that, and you can begin to recognize and say, here I am, Lord. If you can say, here I am, then the Lord will guide you. If you're a little bit astray, he'll bring you back. That's what we have other people for, other Christians. That's what we have the scriptures for. But I will warn you, this is what's not so fun about asking the Lord to speak and then having God speak. Because did you hear the message that God finally had for Eli? Well, it was the second time that Eli heard the message. you need to get your act right. And for the second time, he chooses not to do so. And if you know the rest of the story, you know that his sons die in a battle. He falls off the fence backwards and breaks his neck. His son's wife gives birth and dies in childbirth. There's quite a bit of the time when God speaks to us that he has a challenging message for us. When God spoke to Mary, in one sense, it was wonderful news. You're going to bear a son. But it was not without cost. There was a journey to a foreign land. There was the scandal of being suspected of being unfaithful. I think Simeon called it the most. He said, "A sword will pierce your own heart too." There's one kind of sword that pierces your heart when you have empty hands and you can't hold the child you do so desperately want to have. But there's another kind of sword that pierces your heart when you see your own son of your own flesh being tortured to death. And it's certainly at that moment, Mary had no idea that this was God's good work in the world. But you know, that's often the way God works. Hannah desperately wanted to hear from God, thought God was not listening to her. But when God brought her to the place where she could say, "Here is my son. I've given him to the Lord." The Lord not only blessed her, but he blessed the whole people of God. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So the special music today we have follows the prayer of Richard of Chichester. It's from the movie Godspell, and I went all the way back to the original movie lyrics and scene, and shot in the 60s, it's a clown-based perception of the work of Jesus. It's called Godspell for you younger people. It's just fun. But in the midst of the fun of the visual, hear the prayer that Mary Magdalene sings.
Master,
day by day, day by day, oh dear Lord, three things I pray. Bye.
use Richard of Chichester's prayer. You've just heard it sung in the song. Let us make it our prayer. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. We do indeed want to see you more clearly. We want to see like Samuel saw, so that we do not look on the outward appearance, but we look on the heart. Teach us to listen like Samuel, so that when you whisper in our heart, we might know that it is you. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. We want to love you more dearly. We want to love you like your servant Hannah, who gave back to you the deepest desire of her heart, what she longed for and loved more than anything in all the world. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. We want to follow you more nearly. We do not want to be like Eli, who did not follow you well and could not hear you. We want to hear what you tell us to do, and we want the courage to do it, no matter how easy, no matter how hard. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. We are listening to hear you with more than our ears. We are looking to see you with more than our eyes. We are looking to understand you with more than our hearts. May we have the courage to pray as Richard taught his people to pray when he said, "Thanks be to thee, my Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits thou hast given me, for all the pains and insults thou hast borne for me, O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother. May I know thee more clearly, love thee more dearly, and follow thee more nearly." Hear our prayer, and hear the prayer that pulls all our prayers together when we pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." And as Nelson sings this last song, may the refrain be your prayer as well.
By the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwelt in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turned away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here
I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
God the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus the Beloved, fill you. The Holy Spirit the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen. Amen. Go in peace. Listen for the voice of God. God is speaking to you.
Thanks be to God.